Hey guys, welcome back to Ask an Electrical Engineer. This is part three of the LEDs, the final and maybe the best installment. We got so many questions about LEDs and we didn't want these videos to be so long that they cause people to die of old age before they finish them, so we split it up into three parts. So with that, we're gonna jump right back into the questions about LEDs. All right, moving on. Why do LEDs need a resistor? Okay, cool. LEDs need a resistor because as you increase the voltage across them, they don't go, oh, I have more voltage, everything's great now, everything's happy. If I go higher voltage, everything's good. No, it goes where the voltage goes up a little bit linearly, but then the current starts to curve and go crazy, crazy, crazy. So if you can very finely control the voltage, then you don't need that because you can say, okay, 1.7 volts, I'm good to go. 1.8 volts, I'm good to go. And I just know I will never go over 1.8 volts because by the time I get up to 2 volts, I'm gonna start causing damage because by then that current has gone like this and has gone kind of crazy. But you stick a resistor in there and you make it so once you get over that forward voltage, then you have basically a semi-constant voltage drop over the LED, and then you have the resistor itself, and the resistor makes it so you have a linear relationship between your voltage and your current. So it's there as a protection device. It's there to make it so as your voltage increases past the forward voltage of the LED, the current is still reasonable and not spiking up like a madman. So that is why we have resistors with LEDs. So moving on. Can LEDs be wired in series? Yes. Just kidding. Yes, it can be wired in series, and that's a great thing to do because let's say you have a 9-volt battery and you have your 1.7, I'm just gonna round this up to 2 because I'm terrible with math, your 2-volt LED where you need 2 volts to run this. Okay, so you have a 9-volt battery and 2 volts here, so what are you gonna do with that rest of that 7 volts? That's where you need that resistor. But then you're wasting all of that power in that resistor that's trying to make it so the amount of current through this is okay. So since this is 2 volts, why don't I just put 4 of these in series and then it's 2 volts, 2 volts, 2 volts, 2 volts. That makes 8 volts. And then I have a 9-volt battery. I have 1 volt of like overhead and then the other 8 volts will be dropped over these LEDs to make it so that I am having an LED that is produced, I'm producing basically 4 times the amount of light and using the same amount of power. So LEDs in series, not only is it possible, it's recommended in a lot of situations. Again, going back to the strips of light, LED strips that you can buy for whatever purposes, that's usually what they're doing there, is they are putting a bunch of LEDs in series to make it so that you have the equivalent forward voltage that you need for your system. Moving on. What's the difference between an OLED and LED TV? So I don't actually understand OLED very well as a technology, like what drives it, but I do know what's going on with an OLED versus an LED TV. So OLED TV is basically just a huge screen of actual RGB LEDs. And so when you have your millions of pixels up there and it says, hey, I want this pixel to be green, and that RGB LED right there, the OLED, will turn on the green pixel and say, huh, here it is, and it'll turn on as bright as it needs to, and if it's not turned on, it will turn itself off. And that is an OLED TV. It's literally just a bunch of LEDs putting out light. An LED TV, however, is not quite as cool. An LED TV, it has a screen over the front that has colors, and it controls those colors, and then behind it, it just has rows of LEDs to give it a nice uniform backlight. And that is why OLEDs are so cool, is because OLEDs, you want a dark sky and dark night, you're watching Interstellar and it's 90% darkness for some of those and just a couple of pinpoints of light. Those LEDs, those OLEDs just turn off and so they are black, black, black. Now you watch that same scene on an LED TV and all of the LEDs that are creating the backlight are still on, they're always on. And they've done some things where they'll turn off like certain sections, but even then it's not as direct. And when you have black, what's happening is that screen in the front that's showing the colors is trying as hard as it can to block out that LED backlight, but it's not perfect. You get some light that seeps through and that's why you don't get the same contrast ratios for LED TVs as you do with OLED TVs, because technically OLED TVs, you get infinite contrast ratio. The dark is completely black, just absolutely dark, and then it gets as bright, and anything divided by zero is going to be infinite. Whereas LED, even with it being completely dark, it can't block off everything, so some of that light seeps through, and that's why the blacks will look a little bit white if you're super, super noticing that sort of stuff. Next question. Can LEDs overheat, explode, or catch fire? Overheat, yes. Explode, yes. Or catch fire, maybe? I've never heard of anything catching fire, but if it produces heat, then technically it can catch fire, right? It's just a matter of scale. So LEDs can overheat, and this is something you'll still see. The LED, the junction where the two materials meet, again, most of the electrons that are dropping over, they emit a photon, but sometimes they create heat. And even though it's way better than incandescent, they don't like you to take LED. So like if I took this and imagine this is an actual bulb, they want you to have the LED going up like this, because if you turn it upside down like that, then the heat created at the junction and created in the electronics that are driving it in the bulb, it goes up and fries the electronics. And that's actually a pretty common way for LEDs to burn out. And that's one of the few things that an incandescent is better, is because the heat in an incandescent is in the bulb itself, and the rest of it doesn't really matter. It's just, you know, conductors, and there's no electronics that need to be worried about. So if you have an LED and you put it up like this, then the heat that's generated here and the heat in the electronics all kind of go up to the electronics and melt things. And so that's where you can overheat. Now the explode, I have had an LED explode on me. I tried to get another LED to explode on me and it failed, which was kind of embarrassing, actually. I couldn't even destroy an LED on purpose.
And then it turned back on.
And then it turned back on. Yeah, I don't know what in the world is going on with these LEDs. They're just here to mock me. And there's nothing in the world that's completely safe. I mean, I can be sitting right here at this desk and get hit by a meteorite. There's nothing I can do. And I kind of feel like it's the same thing with these bulbs. Yes, there is the chance that something could explode or catch fire, but it's pretty darn unlikely, and I have a feeling that there's going to be a significant amount of human intervention involved, and not very wise human intervention at that. Next question. Can LEDs power solar panels? Do you know how solar panels work? Do you understand that LEDs use power from the solar panels? They don't power the solar panels. Solar panels generate electricity. LEDs use electricity.
Pretty sure you're talking about pointing an LED at a solar panel.
Oh. Oh man, I really did think that that was just a stupid question. So, with that in mind, can using an LED on, if I shine an LED on a solar panel, which is probably how that should have been phrased, I'm not accepting any of the blame on that misunderstanding. If you shine an LED on a solar panel, it will produce electricity. Now, it depends on the LED, how efficient you are, and the solar panel. Solar panels are designed to be most effective with the sunlight that they are expected to receive. And you can even, I've read about solar panels where they say, hey, if you're in cloudy areas and you are, and the clouds are absorbing certain amounts of that light, certain spectrums of the light, then you want to use these solar panels because they're designed for the light that's going to, that's not visible, that's going to actually make it through the clouds. Whereas if you're living somewhere in California or Arizona where it's just bright, sunny skies all the time, then you want the direct sunlight that you're going to be getting. So with that, your LED, you could have an LED that, like on this one, it's only emitting red. So it's not going to be super efficient because your solar panel is expecting a whole spectrum of light. And this is giving out a very, very narrow band of light. But you make it bright enough, and as long as the solar panel is at all tweaked to accept it, then you should be fine. And it should create power on the solar panel. Again, poorly worded question, not my fault at all. Moving on. How are LEDs protected in an electrical circuit? So the most basic one is just throwing in a resistor. You just have that resistor and it makes it so any spike in voltage or any even just slight increase in voltage does not fry your LED. And then a lot of this stuff is the same things that you're going to be protecting everything else in your circuit. I mean, you've got your TVSs, MOVs, fuses, breakers, you have your capacitors that are going to be absorbing any stray current and trying to suck up any voltage spikes, stuff like that. So really, other than making sure that you don't overvoltage your LED and get it into that crazy current spike area of the current voltage curve, then you just protect them like you'd protect any other electronic component. All right, moving on. How do LEDs dim? Oh, cool. So the two ways is, one, you can turn the LED on full brightness and then totally off really fast. And the way that works is our persistence of vision makes it so even if it's flickering on and off, it looks like it's on. But depending on how much it's on versus how much it's off, it makes it how bright it is. So roughly, if it's on half the time, off half the time, it's going to look about half as bright. And that's pretty cool because it's pretty easy. Now, the drawbacks are, one, you need something that's flickering on and off like that, so you need some sort of driver. And if you want any flexibility, it has to be somewhat intelligent. So that's why Arduinos are so popular, because they're really, really easy to do this with. I mean, you can pick up an Arduino and 10 minutes later, you can have an LED doing whatever you want in terms of brightness flickering on and off. It does have that complication. It also, depending on how big the LED is, you could actually start to create some electromagnetic interference because you're pushing the current on and off so much and you're getting that oscillation that it's actually putting out small, basically radio waves. And that can disrupt other electronics and you're gonna start to have some conformance issues and it just gets ugly. So something like this, that's not a big deal and probably the way you wanna do it. But once you're getting into like stadium lighting or something crazy where you're getting amps of current and you don't wanna have, you know, 10 amps of current flicking on and off 100 times a second, that's when you get into the second way of dimming an LED, and that's simply by controlling that voltage directly. So if you know what you're doing with that IV curve, your voltage versus current curve, then you just change the voltage and measure that current and make sure, like, okay, I'm creeping up the voltage, okay, I hit my current, and it's good to go. And that way you're getting a smooth, persistent output, and you're not getting those huge current spikes and radio frequency emissions and stuff like that. Next question. What are you hoping LEDs can do in 5 years? I'm not very smart. Nor am I incredibly smart. Dang it. I'm just proving my point now. Creative, that's the word I'm looking for. I mean, if LEDs could just keep on doing what they're doing, but even better and last even longer and be even more efficient, then that's fantastic. And the thing is the market just finds places for them. As the LEDs become better, people will have brilliant ideas of, oh, wait a second, now that it's this cheap, I can do that. And now that it's this efficient, I can do that. I mean, that's exactly how it's been up to this point. But that's really it. I don't have anything in particular that I am hoping that LEDs can do in 5 years. I'm just hoping to see them get even better, even more robust. I'm hoping that we'll figure out the electronics so that they don't give out so fast. And I'm really excited to see where they go because LEDs are awesome and they're only going to get better with time. Next question. What are the coolest uses you've seen for LEDs? I think the coolest thing I've seen, and this is kind of ridiculous because I just made fun of them, is the fact that my kids have some shoes that my wife got for like, I think it's $5. LEDs all around the bottom, and they come with a little remote and you can make them be red or green, or you can make them in a disco move. My 4-year-old loves to go and do the disco party move and it's flashing all these different crazy things. And honestly, one of the dumbest things ever. And that is what is so cool about that, is the first red LEDs when they came out, they're like $200 a pop. And now they're so cheap that we just stick them into our kids' shoes and my wife can get them on clearance for a couple of bucks and they're literally walking on them. Whereas you go back 50 years and not only were those colors not in existence, but those shoes would have been thousands, tens of thousands of dollars, even if they were just red LEDs. And so I think that's one of the coolest things, is that they're just They're everywhere. They can do so many different things, and they're so cheap and so ubiquitous. They're cool. So that's what I think is cool. Yep. All right, guys, that's all the questions we got. If you like this video, leave a like. If you have any questions, leave it in the comments below. Subscribe if you want to hear more from electrical engineers, and we'll see you in the next video.